As the country called Tanzania has started attracting worldwide attention, the president of the country, John Pombe Joseph Magufuli, has of course come into very sharp focus. But who is John Magufuli? What has influenced him all his life? What kind of political ideology is he most likely to always lean towards? Okay, we know what he has developed to be. We know he has developed to be a very draconian dictator. But to be able to accurately analyze a politician, one must be able to dig very deeply into their past. It is instructive that this is exactly the same problem Tanzanians had in 2015 when, very unexpectedly, from nowhere, John Pombe Magufuli won the CCM nomination to run for president. There was a very desperate scramble to find out something about this man's past, but people did not come up with much, because apparently Bwana Magufuli is a very secretive person, very quiet, does not talk much. Interestingly, one of the very few tidbits of information people came up with was the fact that Magufuli never eats food cooked by anybody else other than his wife. And a foreign media house, this is really funny, came up with a wild speculation that the reason why was because Magufuli had a phobia, a great fear of being poisoned by one of his many political enemies. There was another bit of information that people ignored at the time and did not seem to be relevant in any way going forward. However, in retrospect, now it is extremely significant. And it is this. During Bwana Magufuli's entire life in parliamentary politics, he abhorred competitive politics. He went out of his way, and went to great extremes to avoid competitive politics. And this is why many times when he was elected virtually unopposed. There was no competition to speak of. Now, there's been a lot of speculation, which would suggest that Bwana Magufuli himself organized, that there be no competition. But nobody has produced concrete evidence, and therefore we'll just have to leave it at that, because we cannot say anything on this channel that we do not have concrete evidence to support. However, this thing of not being opposed in politics has come back in a very big way as he has become president of the country. It has become very clear that the current president of Tanzania does not believe in having any opposition in the country. He does not see the importance of an opposition. To him, an opposition is disruptive to his plans for the country. And so, the opposition in Tanzania has found itself in very hot soup. They have been kept very busy attending court cases on trumped-up charges. Others, like former Chief Whip Tundu Lissu, have found themselves involved in mysterious, and shall I just say bizarre, incidences where non-gunmen pumped several bullets into his car. In fact, the man, it's a miracle he has survived that one. And to date, supporters of the government of John Magufuli have stuck to the idea that actually this was organized by his enemies within the opposition, which is extremely laughable for anybody who understands Tanzanian politics. Now, most of us know that an opposition, a vibrant opposition, is critical in multi-party democracy, any multi-party democracy. They are there to check the government, to ensure that there are no government excesses, generally to keep the government on its toes. Because without an opposition, we all know what normally happens. Because power is a very dangerous thing. And we are told that power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. In other words, it's human nature that give a human being power, yeah, unlimited, unchecked power. And they will most probably tend to lean towards evil, which is precisely what we are seeing in Tanzania today, yeah, with the disappearance, mysterious disappearance of people, kidnappings, killings, journalists having to seek political asylum out of the country for the very first time in the long history of Tanzania. But what should be super interesting for those who have not been following Tanzanian politics, and indeed even for Tanzanians who think they understand their own politics, what should be super interesting to all of us is how the circumstances and the environment, how John Magufuli ended up being president of the country. It is an amazing story, yeah? How this former poor herds boy, yeah, the son of a peasant, in a small village by the shores of Lake Victoria called Chato, yeah, how this man rose to become the most powerful man in Tanzania. But first, a brief background out of politics. John Magufuli was born in Chato on October 29th, 1959. Okay, that means on October 29th next year, 2019, he will be 60 years old. Now allow me a brief aside here. And it is this. Coincidentally, on Thursday, October 29th, 2015, yeah, right on his birthday day, yeah, John Magufuli was declared the winner of the 2015 elections and therefore the next president of Tanzania. Yeah, it happened on his birthday. Very interesting stuff. Anyway, his parents were involved in farming and they also had a small herd of cattle. Yeah, so the young Magufuli grew up being involved in these activities, including looking after the family cattle. And after completing his secondary school A-level education, he joined a teacher's training college and became a teacher, where he taught sciences, yes, more specifically chemistry. Now, many people don't know this, but President Magufuli has also received military training. He received this military training under the National Service Program in the country. He later left teaching, yeah, and started working, putting his knowledge of chemistry to work for a factory in the country. John Magufuli then joined politics in 1995. Now, here is one of the most amazing things about this man's political career. Within 20 years, yeah, from 1995, by 2015, he was president of the Republic of Tanzania. Now, president of a country should be a good manager. Yeah, good presidents are normally good managers. However, it is also extremely important to have enough political experience to make a good president. Now, if we can compare him to his main opponent in 2015 for the presidency, Abwana Edward Lowassa, in 1995, when Magufuli was a rookie, just entering politics, Edward Lowassa was already a front runner for the presidency of Tanzania. In 1995, when former President Julius Nyerere, yeah, dramatically, yeah, frustrated Jakaya Kikwete's bid for the presidency, indeed when it was very clear that he was going to be elected as the nominee for the party, there was another name, yeah, there was another person who Nyerere also rubbished for the presidency. And that man was, of course, Edward Lowassa. But let me back up a little so that we look a little closer at exactly what happened so that suddenly, unexpectedly, to the shock of many, Magufuli became president. When the former president Jakaya Kikwete was finishing his presidential term in 2015, there were two front runners who everybody was talking about, and people knew for sure one of these two individuals would become the next president to succeed Kikwete. Those, of course, Edward Lowassa, yeah, and another man called Bernard Membe. Now, Bernard Membe was the foreign affairs cabinet minister under Kikwete, and Kikwete favored Bwana Membe to succeed him. Now, to those who knew the history of Kikwete and Lowassa, this was a bit strange, because in 2005, Edward Lowassa did not stand for the presidency. He did not vie for the CCM nomination to be the presidential candidate for the party. Why? Because he wanted to fully support and back Jakaya Kikwete's bid, which of course ended up being successful. And therefore it was no surprise when Kikwete became president, he appointed Edward Lowassa as prime minister. But 3 years later, tragedy struck. Yeah, Bwana Lowassa was named in a scandal involving an American company called Richmond. A parliamentary committee named him, yeah, as being involved in a scandal. And the company called Richmond had supplied emergency power generators to the government. And the parliamentary committee found that the government still paid Richmond, although their machines arrived late, yeah, and did not generate much power, but they still got paid in full. And they accused Bwana Lowassa of corruption, yeah, and he was forced to resign. This was unprecedented. It had never happened before that a prime minister in Tanzania would be forced to resign, yeah, because of corruption. This happened just 3 years into the Kikwete presidency. Now, Lowassa, of course, also got named again in other questionable circumstances when the UK government started investigating his son over money laundering suspicions. And one of the companies mentioned by the United Kingdom government was a company owned by Edward Lowassa and his family, which the government of the UK suspected was linked to this money laundering suspicions they had of Lowassa's son. Anyway, politicians have in the past recovered from scandals like this ones in Tanzania. And therefore, as the 2015 CCM nominations for presidential candidate came up, many expected Kikwete to back his old friend, the man who had worked very hard to get him into the presidency, Bwana Lowassa. But instead, Kikwete backed Bwana Membe. But it seemed that Bwana Lowassa's bid for the presidency was jinxed, because even a year earlier in 2014, he had been disciplined by the party for starting his presidential campaigns before the prescribed time. He started too early, and therefore he was banned from politics, meaning that he could not vie for the presidency. But of course, this was lifted shortly before the 2015 CCM nominations. And of course, he went in for his nomination form, along with 41 other candidates who wanted to be president. Yeah, they wanted the CCM ticket for the presidency. Amongst these other 41 candidates was, of course, John Pombe Magufuli. But nobody paid any attention to him. Nobody in their wildest dreams expected that this man would actually win the CCM nomination. Now, Lowassa went out of his way and made every effort to ensure that he would be nominated without any problem. And so, he played his political cards such that long before the nominations were held, he already had a majority amongst the delegates who were going to vote. A unanimous majority. Yeah, and therefore, even as the nominations drew closer, everybody knew it would be a mere formality. Lowassa was going to be the CCM nominee. Now, what greatly helped Lowassa was that there was very serious animosity that grew towards the then President Kikwete. There was anger, amongst these crucial delegates who were going to nominate the CCM candidate, that actually the current president then would impose a candidate on them. Impose and try to use his position to force his candidate through. And so a faction within CCM emerged, a faction that was very determined to frustrate Jakaya Kikwete and his choice. And this faction very quickly gained momentum and great power within CCM. Now, this is politics. Yeah, and in politics, when your opponent does something, you also do something to hit back. And so the Kikwete faction got down to work. And very shortly after that, the elders within CCM, the elders, Council of Elders, which consisted of former presidents of Tanzania, pushed through a motion, to have the name of Edward Lowassa struck out, from the candidates who would vie for nomination of the party. And they had very solid political reasons. The reasons were that the opposition were gaining very fast, rapidly, against CCM. And if nothing was done to stop this rise in popularity of the opposition, CCM would lose power. CCM would lose its foothold on Tanzanian politics. And of course, this meant that they would lose the upcoming presidential election against the opposition. And the only way to reverse this was to make an effort to completely change the image of the party going into the elections. Now, the image that was making the party lose ground so fast, making the opposition so strong, was of course the image of corruption. Many Tanzanians viewed CCM as a very corrupt political party. And so the only way to reverse that image was to present candidates who were corruption-free, had no scandal linked to them. And it was for this reason that these elders suggested, insisted, that Lowassa's name must be removed from the list of candidates. And this was accepted by CCM, and the name of Lowassa was removed. Of course, Bernard Membe, the choice of Kikwete, was a clean guy. He didn't have any scandals associated with him. And therefore, his name remained in the nomination. His name remained on the ballot. And so it looked like this serious power struggle within CCM was going to be won by Kikwete. But the Lowassa team were not going to allow that to happen. And therefore, shortly before the nomination, they reached out to Lowassa, who was now an outsider, and asked him what they were going to do, who they were going to vote for. Because they knew one thing for sure. There was no way they were going to vote for the Kikwete boy, Bernard Membe. And of course, by this time, Edward Lowassa knew very well that he was going to vie in the presidency, but on a different ticket, not a CCM ticket. And therefore, it was in his best interest that he chooses an opponent who was as weak and unknown as possible. And so Bwana Lowassa sent word back to the delegates, who had spent so much time and money and effort to rally behind himself. And now that he was out of the race, they still owed him something. So he sent word back to them and told them that they should rally around and choose a man called John Pombe Magufuli. And so, to President Kikwete's horror, his candidate was defeated very badly in the vote. And the nominee for the CCM party emerged as a politician, an outsider, somebody whom nobody expected, John Pombe Magufuli. However, other strategists within CCM were very happy, because they had a candidate they would work with. They knew very well that Magufuli did not have any link to corruption. In fact, Magufuli already had a reputation for being a firm fighter, very aggressive against corruption in every ministry he was appointed to. These strategists knew very well that's exactly what the party needed to slow down the progress of the opposition, to slow down the march of the opposition into State House, and to ultimately bring it to a halt. But Lowassa had other plans. He managed to get himself to be the sole opposition candidate to face the CCM candidate. Lowassa was very well known right across the country. Indeed, he's the kind of politician you can say is very popular, has always been popular. And so, many observers, many analysts in Tanzanian politics were sure that for the first time in the history of Tanzania, the opposition would win the presidency. And indeed, to date, many in the opposition believe that they actually won those presidential elections. and that what CCM did was pop, 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 pop. They rigged themselves in. Well, we'll probably never know the truth, because what happened is that the Tanzanian electoral body announced John Pombe Magufuli the winner. And that is the amazing story of how John Pombe Magufuli became president of Tanzania. As you have seen, it's a story full of intrigues, suspense, etc., etc. But that's precisely how it happened. Until next time, this is Chris Kumekucha.